Welcome and good morning. Now, there's an association called the County Assemblies Forum that brings together the 47 county assemblies and the speakers of those assemblies that has become the target of a lot of initiatives to woo them to join either Okoa Pesa Mashinani or Okoa Kenya referendum. And last Friday, the governor's initiative, Pesa Mashinani, approached the forum for its support. And one would expect that because they are all within the county governments, they would be together with Pesa Mashinani. But that is not apparently the case. As we will hear this morning from the chairman of the County Assemblies Forum, Dr.Nuh Abdi-Chair, who is also the speaker for Isiolo County.
Tana River County.
I know why I confused with all this. All right, welcome, Dr. Nuh.
Thank you, Makani.
So, you don't seem to have taken a stand as county assemblies whether to support Okoa Kenya or to support Pesa Mashinani. Why is that the case?
I think, Makali, as we've said sometimes back in Bomas, that decision will jointly be taken by the county assemblies and the membership. And we tasked a 15-member lean committee, but again, which reports back to a 47-member technical committee, to look at the issues. The Pesa Mashinani team presented their case sometimes back. So did the Okoa Kenya team, and many other stakeholders we were able to meet. Although the technical team was to report back to the summit, that is the assemblies in general, within a month's time, it wasn't possible because of the logistical challenges of meeting the stakeholders and the like.
Right.
And we were in fact forced to table individual motions in all the 47 county assemblies, seeking for an extension of time so the technical committee is able to finish their part, which assemblies endorsed. And the committee is almost winding up its report, and I think a report should be ready in the next 2 weeks from that technical committee. Thereafter, we will be in a position to call the county assemblies for a summit to either endorse the report or give their divergent opinion on that report. So as of now, the options, as we stated in August,
yes,
on August 23rd at Bomas, still stand. That the county assemblies could either support Okoa Kenya or support Pesa Mashinani, or say no to both of them and have their own referendum, or maybe devise other mechanisms as to how we can address the challenges. But the challenges in terms of amending the constitution,
yes,
are for real, and different from the perception that has been portrayed the last 2-3 days,
yes,
is the fact that our meeting with the Council of Governors was not about Pesa Mashinani. It was about the myriad of issues affecting the running of county governments, and as the two institutions at the county level, that is the governors on the executive side and the county assemblies on the legislature side, we thought we needed to come together to brainstorm on the issues affecting, but at least among the many issues that we agreed was that the current funding to the county governments is insufficient enough, and there is need for more monies to be sent to county governments to be able to finance their budgets and to be able for them to deliver services. That we agree
that
on.
That Dr. Nuh seems to suggest that the referendum, whether it's Okoa Kenya or Pesa Mashinani, is going to get the support of most counties.
No, but
because
but
they
but
have that
but
bench
but
b- bottom
that
line.
That isn't because even the national government from one side has been saying once in a while that they are not objecting to county governments getting more money.
Yes.
So at least if we are convinced as to how these county governments would receive much more funding than what they are currently getting, and without necessarily having to beg with a bow, and that it's a right to the county governments. I mean, for us, that is the bottom line.
Mm.
So that will inform how the technical committee is going to report back to the summit, and it's up to the membership of the county assemblies to decide whether or not to go by either referendum or to have their own referendum, or even say that we have other mechanisms we can devise. So we have to wait for the technical committee to report back.
Last week, the Treasury issued an assignment showing money is given to counties, and money is spent and money is pending. In fact, it's only the Rakani, which is zero. All the other counties and money not spent. Now, what's the justification for asking for money?
No, and I think one myth that has been coming is spending money is not about getting it out of the pocket and going to buy a glass of water over the counter. It is a process. And spending money doesn't necessarily mean it's prudency, because when you spend money, it has to be spent in the right way. The budgetary cycles, the expenditure cycle, the procurement cycles are things that we have to abide. And even the national government at the end of the year was only able to spend 60% of its allocated budget, money.
Yes.
Yeah. And national government had systems that were running for the last 50 years. You don't expect county governments to be able to spend monies just for the sake of spending because they have been given the monies. There has to be procurement process that have to be followed. So at the end of the day, we can only judge county governments by their expenditure at the end of the cycle of a year. And for those of them who are able to explain as to why they were not able to expend monies, that doesn't justify withholding monies from the county governments, because the next cycle is always there for another expenditure
but
cycle.
But the truth of the matter is many counties, assemblies, once they are unable to spend money, not assembly, the county themselves, they decided to make trips abroad.
And that is a fallacy, because you cannot make trips on monies which were not allocated towards trips. Every budget expenditure has got a line that is given to it. So when you say that because monies were not spent at the county level, people will decide and go for trips, that isn't the truth. Because they can only spend the budgetary item that was allocated to foreign travel. Yeah. And the reason as to why the foreign travel has happened at the end of the year is because I can give my own example as a county government. As a county assembly, when the county assemblies wanted to benchmark in August, September of last year, I said we cannot start benchmarking at the beginning of our term. So I can only allow the county assembly members to go and benchmark towards the end of the year when we have implemented most of the policies.
So when did they go to benchmark?
And the benchmarking happened at around May.
For Tana River,
we did is we sent committees. We sent three members of the roads committee to South Africa, together with the executive committee, to go and benchmark on the road networks around there. We sent a team of about five members to Israel to go and learn the agriculture mechanisms and mechanizations around that area. And we had two members of the trade committee and the public accounts accompany the governor towards Malaysia on foreign trade. So what is being portrayed out there is that, you know, county assemblies are on a myriad of foreign.
You tell me, how useful is that trip to South Africa?
And
three guys went to South Africa to benchmark our road network.
Yeah, I will tell you, because if you want to oversight on how things are being done, you must have that experience, because you have a county assemblies that are composed of people who are maybe almost nearly new to politics, or even on issues of public service. So you don't expect those people to just come and exactly, you know, get to learn that, okay, fine, this is how things are done within the public sector, within the government sector. So they may have come from a private background. They need to see how governments work. And South Africa is one of the countries that has a devolved county system, because they have got a provincial legislature for that, to get to know how provincial legislatures are able to oversight the regional governments. Mm-hmm. And that will be translated into how they can be better oversight on issues and relate with the national government in that extent. So whereas people think that people go for benchmarking trips or the like just for a show, no, that's not the case. And when those committees come, they must have something to show for a report that's tabled in that assembly, and that must also be implemented.
Right.
So when you have got 47 county assemblies, and you have maybe one or two county assemblies who might not behave in the best of manner, and not the whole of the county assembly, but maybe a few members or a few committees, it should not be translated to mean that all 47 county governments are wrong.
Yeah.
But isn't it ridiculous that you have, if there are 47 county assemblies, and maybe 5 or 10 go to Israel to do the same thing? Isn't that ridiculous?
And I think that is the reality we have to live in. We have got 47 county governments and one national government, which are distinct in their nature. Whatever benchmarking is done in Tharaka Nithi does not in any way assist members of county assembly or members of the executive in Tana River. They have to do their own benchmarking. That is a reality in the constitution that we have to live with. The best way that now we are trying to move forward, trying to negotiate and have a joint mechanism with the national government, is to see how best these foreign travels can be coordinated.
Yes.
They cannot be restricted, for one. They cannot be moderated by anybody. It is a right for every government within their level to see how best they can use their money prudently.
Yeah.
What can only be done is so that the embarrassment that has been on the air for the last maybe, let's say, 1 year, and this does not apply to county governments alone, it applies to the national government delegations as well, will be better coordinated, and so that the embassies and the consulates of our country back in those countries do not have an upsurge of delegations that are able to constrain their facilitation within that.
Yeah, yeah.
That is the only thing that can be done. We are ready to engage.
On the general level, there has been, of course, you're aware that there is a lot of discontent or people thinking that there's excessive travel by this county county assemblies especially. No, county governments, because sometimes governor leads delegations and so forth. And that is why there has been the call to cap the limit on how much money should be allocated to what within the county budgets, which you have not very received very well.
No, I think, Makali, and that is for sure, because I am coming from Tana River County Government.
Yes.
We are in the month of November. None of my members of County Assembly have traveled, because we've made it a policy. Travels can only be done after December. So let's concentrate much of the first and second quarter of the year towards implementation of other policies and even seeing that the budget implementation happens. And the issue on the ceiling is not one thing that we are contesting. We are only contesting who does the ceiling.
Yes.
The ceiling is a government, I mean, is a budget tool that applies both at the national level and the county level. But the reality is that within the budget framework of the PFM, that is now the current budgetary law that is in use over the whole country, the ceilings are an instrument that is used within the government. At the national level, the ceilings are used in terms of negotiation of how much every sector is going to be allocated between Treasury and the various institutions within ministries within the government, including Parliament and including the judiciary.
Yes.
When it comes to the county level, the county treasury at that level is supposed to negotiate on ceilings within the county assembly and among the various departments within the county government.
Yes.
But here in CRA, you know, all of a blues without consulting anybody, sitting in a boardroom somewhere in Nairobi, deciding how much should be allocated to the county assembly of Tana River. They never asked for data of how much staff I have, what are the functions that the county assembly intends to carry over this financial year. And the reality is that if you call CRA, and I would wish you call one of the commissioners to even come and defend those budget ceilings, or even one county, when I am here, you will see that there were things which were arbitrarily set and were done in boardroom. What CRA is supposed to do in law is that they are supposed to advise way ahead of the budget making process how much they think are the ceilings according to them in recommendations to the executive committee.
Yes.
And the executive is supposed to drive upon those recommendations and see to it that that is the basis of negotiation.
Right.
If the negotiations come to some sort of a stalemate, that is again how things are designed. I mean, when those ceilings are again set, they go through a process of a county fiscal strategy paper being tabled in the assembly. The assembly again has the overall role to decide how much ceilings are again going to be allocated towards every county department. Yeah. When that is done, the budget cycle begins.
But
CRA,
yes,
for this case, gave the budget ceilings according to them in April 23rd.
There must have been a basis for those ceilings.
No, in April, whether there were basis or not, in April, on April 23rd, most counties have already had already endorsed their budgets, because we were way into the ceiling. Yeah.
Yes.
And their recommendations aren't law. They are only recommendations. That's how they stand. Their recommendations can be said. You know, we disagree with their recommendations, and that is why we are in court saying that the budget ceilings of CRA are not binding for one, because it's not intended in law that they should be binding. And second, they were not based.
Isn't that part of the functioning of CRA that they can prescribe?
Yeah. No, they shouldn't prescribe.
Money's allocations therefore prescribe subsequent to that allocation.
They should only advise, and their advice can be. And that is even the way it operates in Parliament, because CRA decided on how much should be allocated towards the county governments, the levels, the two levels of government, between the national government and the county government. Did the National Assembly and the Senate go by the recommendations? No. They said, you're not realistic. And they gave us less money than the CRA recommended.
Yes.
So why isn't that a crime? But it is a crime when the county assembly say, you've given us recommendations, but these recommendations aren't binding because they are not.
The perception is that the capacity of the county governments, especially county assemblies, and the political dynamics in there are so turbulent that an extra hand from outside is required to establish order and sense and sanity, as it were, because of the nature of how county assemblies are. Factions fighting, using resources or positions to punish. I mean, isn't that the Machiavellian nature of county assembly politics?
Let me tell you, Makali, the way county governments and the national government in the constitution was laid out, it has never been laid out in a manner to suggest that there's one big brother of another. And if you look at Article 189, 190, and 191, which talks about the relationship between the county governments and national government. And in fact, it talks about the relationship between the levels of government and even within the level of government that is county governments. It is one of mutual respect. It is one of advice. It is one of consultations.
Yes.
It's one of, let's say, mediation. There has never been suggested the constitution an extra hand to come and to come and prevail upon the
country governments. That is the ideal situation. The anticipation.
And
the result of what became.
And that is the law.
Yes.
And that is the law.
Yes.
We have to live with that reality.
Yes.
And where a commission or the Senate, for that instance, thinks that maybe there is a certain misunderstanding within a county government,
yes,
what they are supposed to do is to come and mediate.
Yes.
When county governments, because of those wrangles, they are saying are unable to function.
Yeah.
The law has been laid out in such a way that it can be terminated and another county government can come into place. Mm. So there has never been put a mechanism, and it wasn't the intentions of the framers of the constitution, neither was it the intention of Kenyans when they were endorsing the constitution, to have a national government that is bossy, to have a commission that is bossy and presiding over county governments.
Yes,
county
yes.
governments are distinct governments,
yeah.
institutions as
well. Right. That's
okay.
That is the law.
Yeah.
But now let's talk about the challenges. I mean, as a speaker of Tana River County, maybe yours is a very organized one. We haven't had the worst fights or, you know, impeachment and other oversight measures taken by the county assembly over governor or within itself or against you as a speaker. But you know that the practice in other counties is very disturbing. Are there any lessons or issues that you have seen emerging that you think need intervention, and what kind of intervention?
Macaulay, I think we have. And when you have got a new order being established,
yeah.
The reality is that when each and every person or institution is trying to find some sort of a mechanism and a space,
yeah.
these wrangles ought to be there. And I want to say that this is not something unique to county governments.
Mm.
And I think as Kenyans, I don't know, we have that very short memory. Because the National Assembly has had two impeachment motions tabled in that National Assembly and about three motions of impeachments intentioned to be tabled at one time. That calls for five impeachments in a national government, in a national assembly, that has been there for all those you know, times, I can talk of 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
So to think that county governments would come into being, and if we go back to history, the first few months, or there was a lot of lamentation from the public that county assemblies weren't having teeth enough, you know, they aren't oversighting, the public resources are going to waste, governors
yeah.
are becoming rogue and using money left, right, and center. And when county assemblies came to crack the whip, again, the county assemblies were labeled rogue, you know, misunderstanding is coming into place, they are becoming power brokers, they are holding governors at ransom and executives. I mean, this double speak has also to stop. So the issues that are currently happening are issues that will happen in any new system.
Mm.
And that is why as a county assembly and a county government, county executive, we found the necessity to come together. Not necessarily to connive with one another, break the law, but at least to find some modalities of having some sanity within the county governments, such that when impeachments happen, they happen for a purpose and for real, and that the politics and dynamics that come into play, though we cannot stop them for good, we are able to moderate them as they happen.
What do you say to the situation where county assemblies want more money, the governor doesn't, so they want to remove him, or the county executives, they differ over money, over personal things, and then you want to lynch
and
the governor. That is happening in counties.
Yeah, and that can't
what do you
happen,
say to that?
And that can't happen, my brother, because for one, we have got laid down in the impeachment process a clear cut mechanism. And for one, you must impeach someone for some reasons, and the reasons are to be there. And one of the reasons isn't, you know, for you misunderstanding on allocation of budget. That isn't one of them.
But they have not refused to budget.
Because if that doesn't, if that happens and you are to impeach a governor, the process of impeachment doesn't end up with the county assemblies. It comes to the Senate. And if the Senate was to find that the mere reasons of impeaching a governor was malice,
yes.
it will be sent back. And that is what the Senate has done with about two other impeachments.
Yeah.
They have endorsed one and they have said no to two. If it was to happen at the county government level where an assembly was supposed to impeach an executive,
yeah.
the recourse is there within the law that that executive can go to court and say, my impeachment wasn't in due process. And a number of cases in court has gone the way of the executive, and those impeachments have been annulled. So let's not think that, you know, these things can happen in some sort of a vacuum.
Yeah, but
so
what about the county assemblies refusing to pass a budget?
And that would happen, and that would happen. Let me tell you, for instance, you know, it's not only unique here. The mechanism in the national government may such be that Jubilee has got the tyranny of numbers in the National Assembly.
Mm.
And that could be the reason as to why they are able to marshal and pass budgets. I can tell you, in Philippines, budgets were not passed for 2 years.
Even in America, they are having problems.
Yes. Even in America, they are having problems
yeah,
because
having problems.
You have got the Congress that is a majority Republican and on a government that is being led by Obama on the Democrat side. Yeah. So this issue of a county assembly and a governor or the executive disagreeing on budget terms, not only on the quantum between the executive and the assembly, but even on the quantum to be allocated towards various sectors, is a reality that we have to live in. And it's the power play that is in democracy. Because that power has been given to the assembly, the representative, the legislative.
But isn't there a fundamental flaw in that structure?
No, it
isn't. Where Malis can rule because of the assembly decides we want more money allocated to these particular things, which are not necessarily project or ministerial county executive functions, but the county assembly wants money more allocated to itself for its purposes, for example, including those travels and so forth. And the governor does not think this is a good expenditure of the money allocated to the county, to the government.
If I may give you, Makali, the reason as to why, and I think we must look at the intention.
Yeah.
The governor is one person elected by the electorate. And you have got a deputy governor for that instance. So the whole executive has got only two people elected by the public towards representation on their own. You have got an assembly that has more numbers in terms of 50, 60. The perception in general terms and in democracy is the fact that you have got a probability of more sense in more people deciding on the fate of the public than you would have to. And that is why county assemblies are supposed to approve budgets, not approve budgets, but they are supposed to pass budgets as they are.
Yes.
And they decide on what to do. They make the changes they want, and that is how the National Assembly is entrusted with the issues of budget making process. Mm. This is different from what it used to be, because I happened to serve in the National Assembly at a time when we were not allowed to change anything within the budget apart from a 50%, I mean not 50%, a 50 cents. Per ministry.
Yes.
That is what you would do. But now in a presidential setup, the power of the past has been given to the assemblies, to the National Assembly, to the legislatures to decide. And that is the reality. So who are they representing? The same public. So if the governor says no, and the assembly says this is the way we want it to be, that is why at the end of the 5-year term, the public and the electorate have again been given a chance to decide. If a county assembly hasn't been deciding for the last 5 years or 3 years on the fate of the public and towards the public good, they are given the way out.
But you know that the higher responsibility and culpability lies with the governor, even though he is single.
It doesn't.
Because money, when allocated to county governments,
yes,
it's presumed that the county government, which is the executive, is really the government that has been given the money.
And that
their legislature is only to regulate its expenditure.
And that presumption is what, and I think because we want to do a lot of civic education, and that presumption has to be corrected.
Yes.
That it is the county assembly which allocates where resources go. It's never the governors. What they do is a proposal from the executive.
Yes, the budget, the money that has come
there. The assembly decides where the budgets go and where the monies go.
Yeah.
And for instance, Makali, assemblies represent a smaller unit.
Yeah.
And every ward and every assembly member comes from an individual sector. You can imagine a situation where a governor would want to, let's say, disregard a certain ward, two or three wards, because according to him, they did not give him the votes.
Yes.
But you have a member of a county assembly coming from that ward.
Yes.
And if the power to make budgets were entirely given to a governor,
You
would have such marginalization even within the county governments that are unprecedented.
Yeah.
That is the reason as to why it has been given to the county assemblies, albeit so that every member of a county assembly decides and ensures that their ward isn't underdeveloped.
Yeah.
And that's the logic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, coming down to that same allocation, what is the merit in having ward development funds as opposed to the traditional separation of
a
powers?
Kind of a CDO for the ward.
And the executive. So why are they trying to have a hand in the till?
I think I had.
And what is your personal opinion about
it? The only reason that could be
is
I want to give you an instance like Nairobi County Assembly. You have got a majority county assembly of members coming from court.
And
you
by
have
one.
Yeah, by one. And you have the minority that is Jubilee.
Yes.
If it was to be decided that the court side would want to alienate the Jubilee side, they are able to pass the budgets without recourse to the entire side of the Jubilee side.
Yes.
So in that case, you know, there is a, what do you call the lesser of the two, the lesser of the two evils.
Yes.
If you were to give it entirely to Kidero to decide on the budget quantums, Kidero would decide to give all the budget quantum and allocations to three wards who gave him the votes.
Yeah.
If you were to give it to the county assembly, the possibility that the court side would override the Jubilee side and ensure that budgets only go to the wards that are more coded would be high. The ward development fund in such an instance would ensure that a certain percentage, whether there is a reality that there is one party overwhelming the other in a county assembly,
yes,
would still receive some marginal funds that would ensure development goes there.
Mm.
Yeah, that is the reality.
So you think that is a good introduction?
I think so, it is.
But the mechanisms for implementation of that is where the problem lies.
That
there is nothing wrong with saying 5% or 15%, in fact, of all the money is allocated to the county
should be allocated equally or proportionately to all the wards. Sure.
But the implementation, the hand of the MCA there is the problem.
And that becomes a problem when it becomes the county with the ward development fund. It doesn't become a problem when it comes to the CDF.
What we've been saying is
let's not have double standards.
Yes.
If the public out there, the civil society and everybody else, even including the courts, think that the World Development Fund shouldn't be in such a way that the members of the county assembly should be part of the execution of the development fund, so should it be decided that the members of parliament should not have role in any CDF monies. So, but there is no way we can allow members of parliament to run the CDF and at the same time deny the ward, members of county assembly not to run the ward development funds. Mm. So the double standards has to stop. Once it is said that blanketly, okay, fine, no legislature should have some sort of a role within the executive functions,
yes,
then everybody will comply.
But that's the presidential way, the separation of powers.
Yeah.
So it is
that we are borrowing from the worst practices in this particular case. What best practices?
We are borrowing from the existing practices within the country.
Which is a bad practice, but that's fine. We have to deal with that as a country. Now let's look at the mechanisms, I mean the functioning between the county assemblies and the governors. There seems to be a breakdown in a lot of these counties, you're addressing this as chairman of all these forum of all these counties. What is the problem recurrent between governors and county assemblies?
Yeah, I think...
And aren't county assemblies acting as terrorists on the governors?
If they are acting as terrorists, maybe that's the way it was destined to be within the lawmaking process, because I think county assemblies have been given powers within their purview to check over those resources.
Yeah.
And would want the public to hold them to account whether or not they are checking out that those public resources are used in a proper manner. Some of the reasons as to why you have got wrangles, not necessarily between the county assemblies and the governors, is the fact that you have got an executive arm of the county government that is composed of, CECs, the chief officers,
yes,
who are also maybe entirely new within the public sector. When issues of non-performance, issues of non-compliance with the budgetary processes, issues of non-compliance on issues of deliverables happen, you have got this frustration within the county assemblies that they do think a certain CEC or a certain chief officer should go home. And you have a governor because they have got an intricate interest. They are the appointing authority of that CEC member. They would think that they would want to protect. And at that level, you would think that, okay, fine, maybe if the governor is also part of the impunity and protecting, because I think that was the case in a number of counties.
Mm.
You would have the CECs being impeached. You would have governors bossing over and saying, we do not want this member to be removed. And that is how the law was staggered. In a number of places, it is purely maybe political. And we cannot, withstand that reality because it happens even in our national government.
Yeah.
And you see, even when there was the impeachment, the proposed impeachment of certain ministers within the National Assembly,
yeah,
a lot of negotiations were done, party mechanisms were put into play, and that is how the issues were sorted out. It's not entirely true to say that you have got wrangles all over, because you have got 47 county governments. The possibility of having even at least wrangles in 15.
Let's say about 15.
About 15.
Are troubled.
Are troubled. That still tells you that, by and large, 80% of county governments are stable.
Yeah.
Yeah. And 80% isn't a bad precedent, for one.
Yeah.
So I think the fact that the media is highlighting a lot on the negative sides and on the wrangles of county governments doesn't necessarily mean that county governments are crumbling. But again, that is the same same reason as to why we thought it's better to come together as the county assembly's forum leadership and the county governments on the executive side, that's the Council of Governors, to see a mechanism as to how best we can mediate even some of the issues that are political.
Mm.
We can't mediate on issues that are basically law, issues of imprudent use of financial,
finances,
issues to do with breakage of the law. At that level, we cannot come in.
Yeah.
Whether it is a speaker perpetuating it and is under impeachment, whether it is a leader of majority or minority within the assembly being removed because of non-performance, whether it is a governor or a CEC. But where wrangles border on issues of political misunderstanding, That is where we thought, as a Council of Governors and a County Assemblies Forum, we can come in and sort out the issues to the best of our ability.
What do you say about the ability of County Assemblies to pass laws? I know of an instance where they copied some bills from Nairobi, some counties. They copy even, they say, how to take care of such a stadium.
Yeah.
And they copy and paste.
Yeah, I think, and that is where we go wrong, because sometimes we do think that county, you know, which are the laws that are passed? A law becomes law when a county assembly passes it and it is printed in the government printers and it becomes an act.
Mm-hmm.
You do not have acts that are copycats, but you may have bills that are copycats. And that is because it is the executive which proposes most of those bills.
Mm.
So because you had an executive entirely of technocrats who were new to the system, CECs of finances, CECs of various departments, what they did is they tried to benchmark with their colleagues from a different sector, and they were trying to get a bill.
Yeah.
But when those bills landed in the county assemblies, they were sanitized, they were cleaned, and they became law that was now systematically tailored for that same county government. But that was then. And a lot of capacity building has happened. The same capacity building that, you know, left and right controller of budget and CRA and many other people were castigating.
Yeah.
But that capacity building has helped a lot in trying to see that county assemblies and the executive side are able to understand the process of formulation of laws, the process of oversight.
Capacity, though, is still something that needs to be worked on.
And it's something that will still be lacked, I mean, will be worked on.
Yeah.
So I think this isn't something that we are going to learn maybe over a day or a night.
Yeah.
And I think for the next 2 or 3 years or 4 years, until you have got staff that are competent enough, even within the county assemblies, because sometimes most of the capacity shouldn't be with the members, it should be with the staff.
Yes.
And we are having an entirely also new staff within the county assemblies.
Yes.
So once we capacity build those county assembly staff, even if, you know, as it happens in the Kenyan politics, where 70% of the leadership that were in were to be changed, the new crop of leadership that would come in are able to find staff who have got that
some
experience within the county
assemblies
to be able to run the issues forward.
Do you think they should raise the standards of education for entry for county assembly members? Or you are happy with the situation as it is?
I do not want to comment on that because I may be told I am biased for one.
But be honest, because
everybody does not want to talk about the threats to our revolution. That's what I'm saying. Mm. But for one, I think when I happened to serve in the 10th Parliament, we tried to legislate on issues of
qualification.
And the thinking of many, and that is how the standards that are being set were challenged.
Yeah.
Was the fact that it is the electorate to decide who they want to represent.
That's the sovereign right.
That is the sovereign right of the public.
Mm.
If the public in, let's say, Tana River were to decide that the best person to lead us to the senatorial position this year is Ahada.
Yes.
And that is their sovereign right that as to how they decided. I mean, we have no basis of telling them this is...
But the Constitution says
that there has to be some minimum qualification may be set by a regulation of, I mean, by an act of Parliament. And that is when Parliament came into being, the reality happened that 60% of our members of Parliament did not even have post-secondary qualification.
Yes.
And the President was petitioned.
Yes.
The President, then President Kibaki, sent back that bill to Parliament. The numbers to override it weren't there sufficient enough, and it was sent back the way it was. And the current qualification for members of Parliament, both in the Senate and the National Assembly and the County Assembly, are such that they should only be able to communicate.
Yes.
That is now the minimum qualification as it stands. And it's not only for county assemblies.
Yes.
And I'm informed that even when members of parliament, I think the last few months, tried to introduce issues of qualification,
yes,
they were met with resistance by their colleagues. Because again, if you were to go and audit the National Assembly, probability that 50% of the members of the National Assembly
don't have that degree,
not only degrees, even of postgraduate education. Is possible. But above all, what we should say is that maybe if anybody was thinking of running for a position of representation, I would advise that those people should be able, at least I think secondary qualification, or at least because what you need is that understanding of the law. And if you must understand the law, at least you must be fluent in those two languages, either English or Kiswahili.
Yeah.
You would have people who have, you know, learned the languages in the streets, are able to interpret the laws the best they can, because all you need is to read and write.
Yeah.
You may not necessarily be a graduate. I mean, when it comes to issues of budgeting, when it comes to issues of sectoral financing and the like, you have got those capacity within the county assemblies to build
technical
on that.
Yeah.
If you see at how parliaments came to evolve, the legislature in pre-colonial times in our country, in fact the colonial times,
yes,
was such that you had some lords who were coming. There were prints which were being prepared. It would be read to them that this is how the law is supposed to be,
yeah,
and they would say we endorse it. Yeah. They can't even read and write. Some
I think, but
yeah,
but
we've come of age. Yeah. We've come of age. We should want where legislatures are not only competent enough in terms of having that, let's say, basic knowledge,
yeah,
but where they're even computer literate and even having, you know, to interact with, because you will be interacting also with other agencies, yeah, and other governments as well. But I think the issues of qualification is not in so so much that someone should have a degree.
But not at a degree, that level, but a certain level, as you said, secondary, fourth form level.
Even if not a fourth form level,
given
there should be some sort of fluency within English and in Kiswahili for those people to be able to understand what are the legislations
but
being
the
passed.
The trouble, and you as speaker can be able to tell this, because the complexity of some of the issues, including those you know, Public Finance Management Act requirements and probing financial accountability, requires a certain level of sophistication. I mean, society has moved on. Clearly, unless the feedback comes from you back to the MP, say, look, this is these are the challenges we're having in our assemblies, no one is going to take that up aggressively.
No, I think they have enough challenges in the National Assembly themselves, and I think
they do not
need us to inform them that there are some legal, I mean, there are some basic requirements of the knowledge.
Mm.
If we lack them, they do lack them as well.
Yeah.
So if they don't find necessary that we should have some minimum qualifications in terms of whatever, and I think that should be it, and we move forward. But again, it is up to the owners of the Kenyan public.
Yeah.
If they do think that the people who should represent them must have some basic qualification, let them vet them at the ballot.
But you see, the ignorance may lead to very disastrous results or beliefs that anybody can represent them. I mean, somebody who is a herder in some rural area may not know what work or job description that member of parliament or MCA the electing is going to perform.
And that is why we are doing civic education.
Civic education.
And we've advised our county assemblies at the various county governments to make sure that their budgets do include budgetary provisions for civic education, to ensure that the public not only get to learn about their rights, but also get to learn what are the expectations they should have of the executive arm of county government, of the county assembly, that the legislature part of the county government, and also the national government.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you say about gender? A lot of MCAs elected were not women. So there was provision that if they elect this, the other percentage must be filled. So that was catered for. But when they came to the county assembly, many women feel, even in the Senate, they are just there, their bodies. They are not regarded, they don't speak, they're just there to fill the seat. Is that the situation?
I don't think so. I think the various county assemblies might have their unique issues.
Mm.
And if I may give you an example, I have got two ladies in charge of two different committees in my county assembly. I have got the
Two ladies were elected or they are nominated?
Nominated.
Did
not have a single elected female in my county assembly. I have got the Public Accounts Committee vice chair being a lady. I have got the Committee on Finance, which is also key, being a lady, the vice chair being a lady.
So why vice? Why not chair?
I have told you I have got two others in two sectoral committees, the one in education and the one on trade.
The chair.
They are chairs of committees. But I have got two vice chairs again, of two critical committees, that the Public Accounts Committee, which is supposed to vet expenditures at the end of the year when the Auditor General tables their report.
Yeah.
And I have got the vice chair of the Finance Committee, which is again key in the county government's operation, being a lady. So there could be unique issues.
Maybe you have put them there because they are just bodies. They have no say in it.
Let me tell you, the reality is that if they weren't in a position to hold those positions, we would never have given it to them. Yeah, would never have been. And I would want to invite you and Makali to my county assembly and get to see how meticulously those ladies perform in my county assembly.
Yes.
So the reality was such that when the nominations were in wrangles at the level of IEBC and party politics, the ladies, members of county assembly the nominated members of county assembly joined a little bit later in the county assemblies when committees in county assemblies were already formed. And that is why you may not find most of them within positions. And for reality, I would want to tell you also that the leader of the deputy in the majority is also a lady.
Yes.
The deputy leader of minority within the minority side is also a lady. So we've tried in the County Assembly of Tana River to find that level of balance and gender representation.
Yeah.
And to entirely say that...
How big is your assembly?
I have 26.
Yes, it's moderate. That's manageable. Yeah, yeah. But also address the matter of the whole, one-third gender rule and how, what the impact has been in multiplying the numbers and swelling the numbers at the county assemblies.
The reality has been that it has not only swelled the numbers in county assemblies, but it has as well swelled the numbers in the national parliament, that is the Senate and the National Assembly.
Yes.
And you know, for once, when Kenyans went and voted for the constitution and said that they would want the minority rights represented, they want the gender rule presented, they were Kenyans who thought. And we cannot avoid the fact that we have got 50% of Kenyans being women. And if they do feel that they are not represented enough in that sphere, and that is what Kenyans voted for, and we have to live with the reality. Unless you amend the constitution, which again has to be for a good cause, because that is what they thought was better for them. If women were again today to go and entirely vote and say that we still want to be there, that is democracy.
Listen,
it's tyranny. Democracy is about the minority having their say.
No,
the majority having
their way. In some situations like Tana River, do you think a woman will ever be elected anyway?
There could be a possibility because we elected a woman, right?
Yeah, but that's going to be another 20 years.
That's because the law requires.
If you go by proportion, then you count 20 years.
If there was a man running,
it is.
The woman would not have been elected.
Yeah, it's possible because I know there were councillors who were elected last time as women. There could be a possibility that you would have women. Because the ones who are already in power in terms of being capacity given through the nomination ought to go for those seats next time. Because they must show their male colleagues that they are up to the task, for one.
It is not a woman's problem. It's a society problem.
But he is saying that if there was a male candidate for the woman rep, the women would have elected a man.
I mean, I leave that to the Kenyan public to think.
We're looking at best practices. I'm asking that in the context of the current referendum questions and ideas. Mm-hmm. Isn't it from our practice, and you are managing one of those county assemblies, yours is manageable. The others, which are 90, 30 elected, 40, nominated, things like that. Isn't it something that we need to fix, even as we talk about review of the, amendment to the constitution, to achieve that representation of women, but in a more modest, manageable, and sustainable financial
way? And that can still be done, because that would maybe require reduction of the units of representation, for one. But I may tell you, Makali, Kenyans are very unique in the way they think. And I do remember that last time when the constitution was being framed and it came to National Assembly, we tried to moderate in such a way that we wanted to have lesser counties.
Yes.
And our proposal was to have only 18 counties. In fact, we wanted to go by the previous provinces of this country and have only 8. We moderated to an extent where we were able to think comfortably of having 18.
Yes.
But again, you had flashpoints within some regions who were thinking that they would never have their own get elected
unless
they're
given a unit.
Unless given a unit. And that is the reality. We had to accept the 47 county governments. And I was looking at those who were trying to propose to reduce the number of counties.
Yes.
I mean, even if they were to go to heaven, it would become very difficult for Kenyan public to vote to reduce the units that they have, because they do think that resources have now come closer. You are taking them back to the center. And that's the reality. So I think we must accept the fact that we have a constitution that will overburden the taxpayers in one way, and that is how they wanted it to be. But for one, Kenyans will feel contented that they are represented.
Yes.
Kenyan will feel contented that resources are closer to them. Kenyan will feel contented that they are participating in the governance of this republic. And that is what it is.
Let's look at the relationship of your seat and the assembly. Across the country, speakers are an endangered species. Because if they don't approve certain moves or desires of the county reps, they are going to be kicked out. They're impeached, and that you have a series of your friends.
That is
who
why
are
himself is
out.
Fearing talking about qualification.
Let me
you'll not be hard criticizing MCS because the hammer will come on you.
No, for one, I think that is a political seat for one.
Yeah.
And a speaker is supposed to moderate, and that is your constituency for one.
Yes.
But if you were to go by the wishes and whimsical maybe
interests,
desires of county assembly members without thinking that they are within the law, then the law will also catch up with you as a speaker. So a speaker should be that person who would say that I am ready to leave this seat any moment. I mean, the impeachment process for a speaker, as precarious as it is for now, depends on the goodwill of members. And you are merely being called in trust by those members to come and preside over their affairs. But one thing members of county assembly should learn is that whether they get rid of Dr. Nuh as a speaker and get another speaker, that speaker cannot enforce any other law other than those laws that are should govern this country.
Yeah.
The constitution, the PFM law, the county governments act, and any other act.
Yeah.
So there could be a recourse within maybe a few county assemblies where they would think that a certain speaker is becoming
It is not necessarily policy, it's becoming money.
A little bit bossy for one.
Yes.
They are not becoming flexible. I mean, you can only become flexible as a speaker within the paradigm of the law.
Yeah.
You cannot bend.
Okay.
You cannot bend.
We look at, for example, the case of Adul in Kisumu. She got impeached. The alacrity with which that replacement was even fixed was completely in disregard of the law.
Maybe to say, because I think that is why courts again exist.
Yeah.
And the impeachment process of a speaker shouldn't be one that should contravene the standing orders. I mean, for now, you have got a process of impeachment of a speaker that can go within a span of 3 or 4 or 5 days. Maybe that's how it was not well crafted within the County Governments Act.
Yes.
Because every other impeachment, whether it's for a CEC or for a governor or the like, you have got a clear provision within even the interim standing orders of county governments.
Yes.
And even for those county governments who may be county assemblies who might have attended amended their standing orders,
yes,
you have a provision which says that any removal of a person from an office, any office, has to be committed to a committee of a house.
Yes.
Because the process and the thought was in such a way that although the assembly would have the final say as to how things should be done, a certain committee is able to probe issues with a little bit of sobriety.
And present the report to the general house.
To the general
assembly, yes.
It can be on a whimsical thing that, you know, the speaker has denied us foreign travel, the speaker has denied us to go for a retreat. It has to be for a clear purpose that a speaker has infringed on a law, or has not been able to facilitate members of county assembly through the service board in the performance of their duty. That has to be explicit.
So in fact, what can the speaker do? If members of a county assembly decide they want to go to Kampala this weekend to go and discuss matters of assembly, or as the Kisumu ones did, they want to be membership to be paid for in the Nyanza Club, and the speaker, what can he do?
You can't just allow things because members of county assembly have requested for it, because you have got systems within county assembly. And I think one thing that,
because you may not have any law to anchor your resistance.
One thing we may need to understand is that we have county assemblies who are entirely new. And you know, these flip-flops, you know, the failures, system crumbling and the like, is something that we expect to go on for a little longer.
Yeah.
Let's say until for the next 2 years or even 1 year,
yeah,
until systems stabilize. But within the county assemblies, you have got a very powerful committee called the Liaison Committee. The Liaison Committee is a committee chaired by the deputy speakers and is comprising of all the chairs of other relevant committees. At the beginning of the financial year, these committees are supposed to come up with a timetable of various committees in terms of travel, in terms of when they're supposed to have their capacity built, in terms of how they're supposed to generate reports, how they're supposed to pacify laws and pass them. And I mean, all those things are supposed to be in a report, again, presented by the Liaison Committee,
yes,
which again goes to some director of committees for them to be able to allocate those resources. And it has to be done within that framework. A committee can't just wake up this morning and they say, we want to go to Mombasa for a retreat. No, it has to be on a clear plan within the county assembly. And that is why a county assembly operates through an operational plan.
Yes.
So if a county assembly was to impeach a speaker because they do think that they have been denied a few niceties,
a
few niceties, they should know that even if Makali was to be the speaker the other day, you can only operate within the law. And Speaker Makali would only be as good as Dr. Nuh, would only be good as an Adul or any other speaker who enforces the law. But where the county assembly thinks that there is a certain speaker who is completely out of order in terms of facilitating the members of county assembly to be able to perform their duties and their role, or is infringing on the constitution or any other law, then the power and the recourse has been given to them for them to be able to remove.
Yeah.
Where a speaker feels that his removal or her removal was not within the law, they have got the courts to run to.
But see, that introduces a lot of turbulence in the governance of the county assemblies.
And that is how the law has set out issues of checks and balances.
Should I, wouldn't you be thinking of other mechanisms or closest to tighten the situation here so that the whimsical nature of these impeachments and the punitive measures taken against speakers are restrained a little.
Macaulay,
there are no recommendations, you think?
Macaulay, I would tell you, for one, I think the law as it is a little bit clearer, if only we wanted to abide by them.
Yeah.
And as I told you, if a process of impeachment or any removal was to be based on the law, I mean, all these impeachments which are happening maybe would have been reduced. Some of them are for a genuine cause, and, yes. And genuinely, members of county assembly should be allowed to carry out their role. But where I told you they are moderated by political, you know, undertones.
Yes.
That is where we feel as a county assembly or a county council of governors, we can come in to see how best to moderate issues. But let me tell you, the law sometimes is not as clear as everybody may wish to be. Honorable Kenneth Marende faced the impeachment, I think, about twice.
Yes.
When members of county, I mean the National Assembly, said we are going to impeach Marende. But I mean, Marende would not be someone who would go and bend the law because he would be fearing an impeachment or the like.
Yes.
And he would welcome you and tell you, okay, fine, you can as well go ahead. And where a member, and in certain places, members of county assembly have tried to impeach a speaker,
yes.
They have been unable to remove it, for one. Secondly, there are those who would remove a speaker, another speaker would come, and they would face the same systems as they were before.
Yes.
Because you cannot break the law.
Yes.
A certain speaker would not come in and say, okay, fine, Dr.Nuh was impeached because of these processes. I mean, I'm going to bend. Because if, as a speaker, you are going to bend the law or break the law again will catch up with you.
Mm.
I would rather be out there as a Kenyan citizen,
yes.
Doing my own business and co, rather than being shoved to court because I broke the law,
yes.
And just because I feared some impeachment.
Right.
So
right.
I think, as I told you, these impeachment processes,
yeah.
Maybe whether they are genuine or they are not, they are a little bit of shakiness.
When
the constitution came into play, I would rather equate it to some sort of an earthquake. And when you have an earthquake happening anywhere, you have got those boulders that have to fall in place, you know, to find a blessing, some aftershakes, you know, a few rumbles here and there. But at the end of the day, county governments and the different levels of government, the national government and the county government,
yeah.
Are going to find some sort of a suitable platform in which to relate and correlate. And I think things are going to stabilize.
You are talking about ideal situations where laws are not supposed to be broken. But laws are being broken every day. Look at the way at the speaker for Embu, the kind of personal quagmire he was in. That has nothing to do with the breaking of the law. You see?
I'm not aware of any personal quagmire.
You don't remember that he was out in the cold for a few days.
Yeah, that one I know that there was the report that he was abducted.
Yes.
A matter which I think is still in court that I don't want to comment on.
It's an investigation.
And investigation. And those things are bound to...
So I'm saying you're talking about an ideal situation.
Yeah, yeah.
Something
yeah.
can happen like that. Because you're a speaker, you find yourself...
Yeah, and when it happens, we will have a way to deal with it through the law.
But I'm aware that... isn't it a fact that you speakers... are feeling very threatened by, you know, assemblies sometimes. I mean, what is the general experience of your colleagues?
Any speaker would feel threatened. You have got Honorable J.B. Muturi the other day.
Yes.
When some court members came forward and said they're going to remove the speaker. I mean, even when they don't have the numbers. So, you know, politicians generally, that is how they are crafted. Maybe when they don't seem to have their way, they would want to threaten anybody with impeachments.
Yes.
And that isn't unique only for county assemblies. It happens even in national parliament.
Yes.
But the reality is that, and that is what I would want my members of county assembly to know, is that whether you remove a speaker today and you are to get another speaker, there is no way you're going to get a speaker that would be compliant to break the law, because everybody would get into the reality, they would read the law, and they would implement the law as it is.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay, just feedback from our viewers. They say, Daktari, you are clearly eloquent because of education. So a degree should be a minimum. Why are you not recommending? You're shy from attacking some of your colleagues, your MCS.
I don't think my eloquence or my clarity has anything to do with my degree.
Yeah.
Because you might have people who are even better and more eloquent than I am who do not have degrees.
Yeah.
Yeah. But
well,
I think a few personal gifts that... maybe individuals would
have. But I think you don't think you are fair when you say any herdsman. And if the people design the herdsman will be your MCA, that's right.
But that is the sovereignty given to the people.
People need to be guided.
No, you say, you know, even if you were to say that it's a guided democracy, that is why we are giving it to them to elect one person. I mean, if you did not guide them, they would elect 10 people. So that is the much guidance you can give, that give the best among yourselves. And if they so decide that it has to be Ahada, who am I to say no? I would have to lead with that person and contend with him or her.
Mm. Well, tell us about the insecurity in Tana River.
Insecurity in Tana River is, I would say Tana River is stable as of now. We've had our bad share on issues of insecurity. I wish my colleagues and the public about in Pokot and in Baringo, in Turkana, in Samburu, stability, because these are problems that are entirely, mostly faced by pastoral communities, or where you have got that underdevelopment, where we fight over resources and the like. But Tana River as of now is stable.
But as of now, what guarantees that is not going to repeat?
Guarantees are such that we try as much as we can as leaders to see the inclusivity of each and every community in making decisions in the leadership and in the running of the affairs of the county government. And where we think that a need arises that we ought to leave and mediate. And I think as of now, we even have a distinct department and institution within the executive arm that is dealing with issues of cohesion. And we have got a county assembly committee that has not any other function but primarily work on issues of cohesion. So that is the best that we can do as leadership. And we'll try and plead again with our public that, okay, fine, you are better off because of peace and tranquility, that if you go into some quagmire and have some wrangles and fights, then you would never be able to reap the developments that you currently are.
The government is setting up a big irrigation scheme there.
Yeah, in Kulalu and Galana, that is coming. But we are trying to see as much as we can how to engage the
How is that going to affect the local community?
It is in one way, because part of the negotiations we're trying to have is to ensure that when the Galana scheme is set up, we have adequate land left out for grazing facility, and that you have got enough of the people of Tana River having allocated portions in those land to see that they are able to benefit in the irrigation. Yeah. Because we would not want just multinationals to come. You have big irrigation farm, because something has to at least cascade down to the people and the populations if we do not want upheavals against their projects.
There was a move during the last government to give chunks of that Tana River land to some country to come and grow food for their own people.
And that is why we have a county government that would be responsible enough to ensure that such things don't happen.
I think it was Qatar or
something.
It was Qatar.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
All right.
So it failed. No, so
yeah, it did happen.
All right. No, let me just thank you. I think we have to come to an end of to the end of our conversation. Very good feedback for you. Apparently, people seem to agree with the your defense of the county governments. You know, very able presentation there. Washira in Nairobi, Mrs. Washira in Nairobi says, Dr. very clear, eloquent presentation, wide knowledge of how county assemblies work and so forth. You know, people say that you should run for president, Bwana. Sasa hiyo utasema nini?
I do not have intentions of running for president, but I thank those who proposed me for that position.
People are very appreciative of your whatever. Final question, perhaps. COG, Council of Governors, and your county assemblies forum, any level of cooperation, and what is the future of your unregistered, oh no, non-statutory county assemblies forum? The COG is a statutory body.
Yeah, I think we've come to an agreement that county assemblies forum ought to be legislated for and provided for within an instrument. An instrument of.
Maybe should included in the county assemblies.
In the Intergovernmental Relations Act.
Okay.
And for one, we've decided that we will cooperate on matters. We will consult on issues that affect the county governments, even including the legislations, because our approach has been haphazard. Mm. You have Council of Governors going to present a certain position to the Senate. You have got the county assemblies being called upon maybe to present a certain position. And we thought as county governments, we must first consolidate our positions. Whether we agree or not at the end of the day, we must consult and see to it that we have got common positions on matters affecting county governments. And the cooperation has just started, and we think we will engage more. We have a 10-member committee now, 5 from the Council of Governors and 5 from the county assemblies forum to moderate on issues. And even as of now, to work out on the issues of the budget ceilings that has hampered the running of the budgets in the county governments.
Okay.
And we do believe that we'll come to some sort of an agreement on issues.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. We hope to have you back when your committee has brought back the recommendations on the referenda, whether Okoa Kenya or Pesa Mashinani.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Nuh Nassir Abdi, Speaker for Tana River County and the Chairman of the County Assemblies Forum that brings together all the 47 counties, county assemblies, was our guest this morning, looking at the operations of the county assemblies and any challenges they're facing. Keep on watching Power Breakfast. Let's listen to Red a Cappella one more time.